Good afternoon. We gather here today to say goodbye to Robert Bob Schmidt. Many of us know that when you go out into the desert and look up at the sky in the middle of the night and see those countless stars smattered above you, that many of those stars actually died long, long ago. But the light keeps moving. The light keeps traveling, touching planets and bodies across the universe for eons afterward. And so it must be with Bob. Bob loved many things. Bob loved his friends. Bob loved his wife. Bob loved his work, multiple careers, apparently. I don't know many folks who go to medical school after the age of 50 because they decided they wanted to. Very impressive person. And above all, Bob loved life. And a person like this surely shines on after they leave us, regardless of what we may or may not believe about any sort of afterlife. And yet, even though Bob's light continues to shine in the world, we grieve. And this is proper, this is correct, because grief is the toll of love. The depth of grief is inversely proportional to the love that was felt in life, and so we will grieve. Some of us here who loved Bob will be grieving for the rest of our lives to some extent. And I urge those of you who are in grief, who are moving through grief, to grieve with one another. Grieve with others who are grieving Bob, who have grieved others. And if you know somebody who was close to Bob and you didn't know him very well or you didn't know him at all, I urge you to move in and sit with that person in their grief. You don't need to say anything. You can just be with them. Because grieving alone is the worst thing. Grieving with one another allows us to share that weight. But today we are going to grieve and we are also going to celebrate. We're going to celebrate Bob's life. We are going to celebrate some of the things that he loved, including some of the beautiful music that he loved. And we're going to do that together. I invite you first to join me in a meditation. Come to a comfortable seat. If you can have both feet on the floor, please have both feet on the floor. And if you feel safe, please close your eyes. Feel the support of the chair and the floor, the support of the earth. And feel the lightness of the air around you, the lightness of your breath. And now, if you don't or didn't know Bob, please picture the person that you have come with who did know him. I invite that you to hold them in your heart lovingly as we move through this meditation. Now, if you did know Bob, I invite you to picture in your mind's eye one of your most joyous memories with him. And if you can't narrow it down, you have my permission to take some poetic license. It can be an amalgamation. Try to picture it as if it's a scene from a movie, a still from a movie, captured in time. And now notice where this image lives in your body. If it's up in your head, invite it to come down into your heart. And hold that image in your heart and give it a hug. Hug that image with gentle but firm pressure until it starts to reduce into a small, shining jewel. Smaller and smaller until it becomes a gleaming jewel in your favorite color. Know that you have that jewel inside of you for always. You can always return to it. During your happy times, during your sad times, it will always be with you right there. And now picture Bob as the last time you saw him. Know that he is held by a love greater than any of our understanding. Hold him close and let him go. When you're ready, open your eyes. And we'll now listen to a song by Wyatt DeFord on, I believe, one of Bob's favorite guitars.
I shouldn't editorialize about Shakespeare, but I will. This sonnet is about the permanence of love, that love lives forever, as you put it at the beginning today. Our love of Bob will stay with us forever. Let me not, to the marriage of true minds, admit impediments. Love is not love which alters when it alteration finds, or bends with the remover to remove. No, it's an ever fixed mark that looks on tempests and is never shaken. It is the star to every wandering bark whose worth's unknown, though his height be taken. Love's not time's fool. The rosy lips and cheeks within his bending sickle's compass come. Love alters not with his brief hours and weeks, but bears it out even to the edge of doom. If this be error and upon me proved, I never writ, nor no man ever loved.
Thank you. hope all of you that are getting up to speak get a chance to stand up here, because it's a really heady position of power. First of all, I would just like to start out with some thank yous. And I really do want to thank my many friends who are here. Your love and support has been limitless, truly. And I will never be able to thank you enough. So thank you. And I would like to thank the leadership of this beautiful church, my church. First of all, Reverend J. Sylvan and David Owens and Stephanie Park, if she's still somewhere working or gone home for a well night's sleep. And Tristan Moore up there in the choir loft is there doing, handling everything technologically speaking. So please thank them with me for making this such a special day. And of course, I want to thank all of you who have come here to help us celebrate Bob today. I think Bob would have been very touched to see so many of you here today. It would have meant a lot to him, although he also would have hated it. He actually really disliked being the center of attention, and he hated a lot of fuss. And he was absolutely adamant about not having a funeral. So it was like, I was out of the question. But I told him that I was going to have a memorial service and that he didn't get a vote. First of all, because he wasn't going to be here. And the second, because it wasn't for him. It was for us who remained, who cared about him. And a lot of people don't know that Bob and I were married for 33 years. And we met through a personal ad. So this is a long time ago, in the days before Bumble and Humble and Twitch and Twitch and Quinge and whatever else there is out there these days. In those days, you actually wrote an ad and you placed it in the local newspaper, and then people would write you letters back. So you actually got to, you know, read a letter and hear back from people and got to know each other a little before, instead of swiping right and left. And so I wrote an ad when I moved from New York to Minneapolis in 1990. And when I moved, I literally didn't know a soul in the entire city. So I wrote my ad, and then Bob replied with a letter saying that he was going to sue me for plagiarism because my ad was so close to an ad he'd written a month before. And it was actually a little uncanny, because it was, you know, well, the usual, oh, I love to travel, love to eat in restaurants, but it was also like uncanny things like we both played a musical instrument, and we both liked to shoot pool, and we both described ourselves as practical, curious, and very independent, and I'd underline that very independent point, because I'm going to come back to it in a little bit. So, and I would say that over the years, many people told us that we were one of the happiest couples that they'd ever known. And it is true, we were extremely happy. I think that that was something that we never took for granted. In the 33 years, we remained grateful to and for each other. And from time to time, people would ask us, you know, what we thought was the secret to a happy marriage. And, you know, of course, there are a lot of things that go into that. But Bob and I would talk about it, and ultimately we decided that the secret to having a happy marriage wasn't about finding someone perfect. It was about finding someone whose neuroses meshed well with your neuroses. Right? Because no one in this world is perfect, certainly not me, and not, this might be controversial, not even Bob. But when it came to the small things, we just agreed that we wouldn't quibble about those. We started that way from the beginning, and we never did. And when it came to the bigger things, you know, the things that some other people might consider neurotic tendencies, Well, you know, in each other, we just, I don't know, we accepted them. We embraced them, even. You know, there's not enough time for me today to talk about all of my neurotic tendencies. That's like... but Bob's, some of you might be a little familiar with. Bob had itchy feet. In Bob's life, he visited all 50 states, he lived in 2 continents, and in 26 different cities. And from time to time, in the 22 years, first 22 years that we were together, Bob moved 17 times. 22 years, he moved 17 times, which was 10 times more than I did. And the reason for that was because every 9 months or a year or once for 2 years, he would move somewhere else to pursue a degree while I stayed put for my own career. Now, I think that a lot of people thought we were always either on the verge of breaking up. People would say, like, you know, where's Bob? And I'd go, oh, he's over in, he's in Chicago getting a degree. And people are like, oh, that's nice. people thought we were either on the verge of breaking up, or they just thought we were crazy. And I'll say, you know, maybe we were a little crazy. But mostly we just had faith in each other. You know, we believed in each other. And we also believed in the words of J.R.R. Tolkien, who said, all who wander are not lost. And Bob... ultimately pursued his wanderings because he didn't just have itchy feet. He had an itchy brain. You know, his intellectual curiosity and his absolutely insatiable drive to constantly be learning and growing and understanding more things was just an inextricable part of who Bob was. It was like factory installed equipment. You just could never have taken it away from him. And so over the years, he actually earned at least 14 university degrees. And I say at least only because that's at the point I stopped counting. I was like, okay, I know there are more in there, but I don't remember them anymore. In addition to his MBA, his MD, and his PhD, he had master's degrees in, among other things, paper chemistry, chemical engineering, biochemical engineering, clinical epidemiology, pharmaceutical medicine, and my personal favorite, molecular genetics. I was like, I like the sound of that. He was also a Six Sigma black belt, which I love because it just sounds so badass. Yeah, he's so quiet guy. He's like, you're a Six Sigma badass. All right. A good friend of ours actually refers to Bob, calls Bob a mental Swiss Army knife. Which is very, very apt line. But he was also a real Renaissance man. You know, he played beautiful classical guitar. If you never got the chance to hear him, I'm sorry, because he really was something else to listen to. But he also really loved the outdoors. He was a lifelong skier. When he was younger, he was an expert solo backpacker, like the kind of people that pack a bag, go out into the wilderness for 10 days, and then miraculously return having lost 10 pounds and being tan. He was also a whitewater kayaker when he was younger. So he was really, really out there in the wild. And I don't think I have to tell a single person in this room, Bob was just flat out funny. He was one of the funniest people I've ever met in my life, and I was really grateful. I was so lucky. Bob made me laugh every day we were together, and that is no lie. And he had that incredible, infectious laugh that he would start laughing, and you would start laughing even when you didn't know what the joke was. There were so many times when I would sit at home, and his office was kind of over in the other part of the house, and I would be sitting in the kitchen or something, And I would hear him laugh, and he would be talking to people, and I think sometimes a lot of people who are here in this room, and I would start laughing just because he was laughing, and I couldn't wait for him to finish his phone call so I could come out and say, "What were you laughing at? What was so funny that you were discussing about clinical epidemiology that you and I were, you know, cracking up about lab medicine?" And the other thing that I loved about Bob was he was just endlessly fascinating. He was just so interesting to talk to, you know. I learned so much from him that was just entirely outside of my realm. So it's because of Bob I know the three laws of thermodynamics, or things about artificial intelligence and the difference between artificial intelligence and machine learning and deep learning. Like, where would I ever have picked that up? But the great thing about Bob was it wasn't just, you know, his vast stores of scientific knowledge. He taught me practical things as well. You know, for a while we lived up there in Minnesota, and there was a trip that we were taking. We were traveling down through Minnesota and down through Iowa. And I don't know, once you leave Minnesota, Minneapolis, and you're traveling south, it is nothing but corn and cows for miles, miles. Now, the thing is, I'm a city girl. So Salt Lake City is the smallest city I have ever lived in by far. But Bob, most people don't know this, grew up on a farm until he was 11 years old, and his family moved to Seattle. So he was a farm boy from, you know, early ages. So we're driving down through southern Minnesota and Iowa, and it's corn, and it's cows, and it's cows, and it's cows. And Bob's explaining the difference between, you know, Herefords and Hartfords and Holsteins and whatever they are. And I'm like, cows. Million miles. Cows. So eventually, I'm sitting here, I'm looking out the window, and I'm looking out the cows, and I turn to Bob and I go, "That's so weird." Off in this distance, I say, "So weird, there's this one cow that's just really, it's really pretty. I don't know how to describe it. It's just weird. It's just like a really pretty cow." And Bob looks over and goes, "That's a horse." See, I learned something. Mostly to keep my thoughts to myself. But you know, the best thing about Bob, best things about Bob weren't his intelligence or his sense of humor or even his vast knowledge of farm animals. The best things about Bob were really his kindness and his generosity. I don't think Bob ever owned a single thing that he wasn't ready to give away if he thought somebody else needed it more. In his lifetime, he must have given away 1,000 books. Maybe some of you have been recipients of that. He just, if he had a thought or you had a project or something that you thought, you know, he thought you needed help with, he had a book for you. Must have given 1,000 away. Which was not hard, because at one point his home library was 4,000 books. And may God strike me dead if that's not the truth. But it wasn't just, you know, books. Bob must have given away a whole Best Buy store worth of computers and technology. He gave away virtually once. He gave away a guitar. Screen this up. He gave away guitars, and once he virtually gave away a car. It was to a student of his at USC who was really talented and he thought could get ahead. And this poor kid in Los Angeles was going to school full-time at USC and commuting to two jobs on LA public transportation. If you've ever lived in LA, you know what I'm talking about. And he virtually gave away this car to this kid. But the even better things about Bob were the things he gave away that were not material, you know, that he gave of himself so often. You know, there are times to many, many people that he gave his time and his advice and his support and his guidance and his mentorship and just any kind of, sometimes he just gave people belief in themselves. And it was only because he enjoyed seeing other people succeed. It was just something that he liked. At the University of Utah and at ARUP, he often reached out to other colleagues, often colleagues who were just coming up in their careers, and either helped them with their research or gave them, you know, invited them to be on the research papers that he was working on. And it was so interesting to me because at this point, Bob now has such a vast, his knowledge was so vast and so deep that he could be looking at a problem in one area, and he had such a vast array of knowledge from so many other areas that, and with his unique kind of problem-solving ability, he could look at something that was from some completely disparate field of study that he had and apply it to, you know, he could apply something from, I don't know, biochemistry or clinical epidemiology or his MBA and apply it to his problem in this completely different field and figure out a way to solve something. It was absolutely astonishing by that point. And that's where that all who wander are not lost came back into play. The other thing that I think maybe some people don't know is that when Bob, towards the end of his career, he gave middle authorship on his papers often. He took middle authorship on his papers and let other people have, his co-authors have first or last authorship. Now, people in academia know that's a really important position where you are on that list. And not being as naturally generous as Bob, I would ask him why he was doing that, because I knew how much work he put into those papers. And he said, you know, at my stage in my career, first or last doesn't matter much to me anymore. But to my co-authors, where they are in their careers, it might matter to them someday, whether they were first or last. And I'll say, I don't work in academia, so I can't really speak to it, but I think that kind of generosity, that's probably pretty rare in many fields. While I'm talking about the U and ARUP, there are so many of you here, I just want to know, I just want you to know, how much he enjoyed working with you. He had such high regard for all of you and took such tremendous pride in the work that you accomplished together. And I hope you already knew that, but if you didn't, you know, now. And it's interesting thinking about Bob and his doctor as a career, which was his last one out of many. And I recently reread the Hippocratic Oath, which, again, many, many people here I know have taken, and Bob took, and most people I've only remembered the do no harm, right? And but this time I was really struck by something that I hadn't remembered, and it's part of the Hippocratic Oath that says, I will remember that I remain a member of society, with special obligations to all my fellow human beings. And I read that this time, and I couldn't help but think of Bob. I couldn't help but think about his sense of caring and his feeling that he truly did have an obligation to help other people. And all of that kind of brings me back to the topic of a happy marriage. Because the truth is, I didn't just marry someone I loved. I married someone I admired. And I know that Bob made me want to be a better person. And I think the world would be a better place if more people were like Bob. Now, he would be hugely embarrassed to hear me talk about him like this. He would. Another thing he would have hated about this, because in addition to everything else, he was so humble. Bob genuinely never thought he was all that special. But you and me, we know different. And I'd like to say now, just to talk about one of his last acts of generosity. Just before he died, he wanted to give one of his beloved guitars to someone that he thought would appreciate it and enjoy playing it as much as he had. So I'd like to reintroduce Wyatt DeFord, a very talented student up at the University of Utah, who's going to play another one of Bob's favorite songs on Bob's favorite guitar, and what I hope is now Wyatt's favorite guitar. Thank you all for coming. Thank you.
We will now open it up for remembrances from friends. We do have a few folks who have signed up in advance to speak, but after they speak, we will open the floor and anybody can get up and share remembrances. So first, we will hear from Elizabeth Sanderson.
Short, so I really like it up here. This is like flying. It's great. There are so many things I adored about Bob. We had tons of adventures together with our dear friends, from whitewater rafting and skydiving to canoeing, snorkeling, and jumping off high rocks into freezing cold water. We had simple moments just hanging around and enjoying one another's company. Throughout our escapades, Bob's pure joy remained consistent. He was always laughing and making us laugh. Marianne, Bob, and I shared a love for animals, and we'd swap wild sightings from our backyards or animal videos from our travels and funny things that our four-footed roommates did. I can still hear Bob laughing when he told me about that one semester, as he was getting one of his many degrees, he really got far behind his schoolwork, because he kept playing car mechanic peekaboo with his cat. His cat would lie on his back, put his paws on the bed frame, and slide himself out from under like a car mechanic pulling himself under a chassis. Bob said he would pop over the bed, trying to get a glimpse of the disappearing feline ears. He played for hours and hours, nights and nights. When he told it, you could just feel his sheer joy. Then there's Bob's brilliance. I'm sure most of you have felt his generosity of genius. He knows so much. He knew so much about so much. He could synthesize so well from his vast knowledge. Every once in a while, I'd call him and ask him a question, I don't know, about multiple regression or some model I was trying to create with very faint skills, probably at 11 o'clock at night before I needed it the next day. He kindly answered, and then gracefully answered the question I should have asked, saying something like, well, another way you could think about it is. He never let me know he had 12 more degrees than I had, or that his IQ was certainly several points higher than mine. He made the complicated so beautifully simple and understandable. Another thing I'll always cherish about Bob is his love for Marianne. I don't know about all of you, but when I'm low, I search for little happy things in my life. And thinking about Bob and Marianne is one of those joys. Their love for one another was so heartening. They were so proud of each other's accomplishments. They regaled each other with wild and baffling news of the day. They just took great pleasure in laughing together. They not only loved one another, they really liked each other. And no matter how far they were away, they always had each other's back. They were always there for each other. When Bob moved to Utah to start his new job, Marianne was still in Australia. Shortly thereafter, I had the great fortune of working in Australia, thanks to an introduction that Marianne made. I was going to throw my bags in her closet for a couple of weeks while I found a place to live, but at the end of that time, we had so much fun that Marianne asked me to stay. I felt so lucky to work on the other side of the world and have my good friend there. And I think Bob was the happiest of all of us because he knew Marianne would have a buddy to help bridge the gap until they could be back together again. I can't tell you how many times he thanked me for being there. Our hearts have all been broken with Bob's passing. They break for our loss, and mostly they break for Marianne's loss. We all want to be there for her, to do things we can. We want to fix the unfixable. So when Marianne asked her amazing friend Valencia and me to help get some things together for the reception, we jumped the chance. We were running around for flowers and wine and food. My body felt that familiar anticipation of getting together to see our friends. But then I remembered Bob wouldn't be there, and the sadness started taking up residence in my chest, getting heavier and heavier And after finishing our tasks for the day, we sat in the kitchen. I was searching for light, and I remembered last week's dream. Bob was in it. He was really happy. We were all together at a great big house on a huge hill. Bob and I were running, careening down this really long backyard. And we came to a steep part, and I stopped. And I said, "Bob, I don't think I can make it." And he paused, and he turned, and he gave me one of those famous Bob smiles with a twinkle in his eye. And I instantly felt hope and optimism. And then the hill turned into warm sand, and we slid down the chute like Indiana Jones, and we joined the others. And it was at that moment that I knew we're all going to be together again. We just need to be there for each other until we can.
Next up, we're going to hear from Ben Witt. And you can either climb these kind of ridiculously high stairs, or you can speak from this microphone. So it's up to you.
I mean, I will go level with everybody. Well, thank you, Marianne. Thank you all for letting us all be together today. My name is Ben Witt, and I first met Bob about 14 years ago when I started as junior faculty here at the University of Utah. And oddly enough, after his illustrious career, Bob was one of my first residents. And I had a lot of angst and anxiety as junior faculty. And through the course of that first year, I kept thinking to myself that this was like the perfect guy I could meet as a as a resident, because you know, I was supposed to teach Bob microscopic findings, and Bob just had a way of making it pretty clear that he's probably not going to go into that, but it very clear that he was very interested in the inner workings of it, the thinking of it. So it was almost like I could practice how I teach with somebody who, like, wasn't really going to go into the field, but who knew a hell of a lot about how to teach well. So, you know, as we would sit there, I mean, my sessions with Bob were so much different than really any other resident is you would imagine. But, you know, he'd say things like, "When you say it like that, I can totally follow you. I see where you're coming from, and I don't really have to look at the cells." Other times he would kind of be like, "You know, Ben, I think I can tell you're one of those people who says more when they say less." I thought about that walking in here today. I'm like, maybe I shouldn't say that much today. But so yeah, he would just leave me with little gifts every day like that. The other thing with Bob was he had such a natural way of bringing people together. So, he would say he had an idea for a study, would I be interested? I'd say, "Sure, Bob, that would be great." And then he'd say, "Okay, well, it shouldn't be too long here." And soon, like within a week, we'd have a working group. We've had two meetings. Probably within three, we would have the final draft, or largely Bob would. But then it's like, and I think this kind of has to do with what Marianne was saying, the breadth of his scope was incredible. So when he had that group of four or five people together, he would get three more ideas, and then it would lead to more things. But when I was first hired at the U, our chair said to me that he was almost positive he'd never hired anybody who had zero publications. I was the first. Within a year of meeting Bob and also Lester Layfield, who I see here today, I had five. That's just within a year. So, you know, another way of easing the angst of a junior faculty member right there. was Bob. This is just my safety blanket. I don't even need it. I'm just double checking. You know, I wasn't there the day he was diagnosed. I found out later in the day he had come in for the biopsy. But I had found the fellow who was on that service who was in the room for his biopsy, and I asked her, her name's Tori, how was Bob? And she said, I can't really explain it, but he just kind of made us all feel like everything was going to be okay. You know, and talk about just, I mean, who else but Bob could find a natural way to be in a situation like that. The last time I talked to Bob at length, we were outside, and we were talking about the phases of life, and I know it was not a humorous conversation. I also know that he had way more phases than me, but even though it wasn't humorous, yeah, that his natural laugh, I know, rung clear several times. So, you know, as we were just thinking, meditating earlier, I was trying to hear his laugh. But, yeah, Bob is one of those people that I'll never be able to repay, you know, what he did. That would be impossible, but I do want to deeply thank you, Bob. Thanks, everybody.
And finally, David Grenache. Did I pronounce that right?
You did.
Excellent.
Many people don't.
Going to go Grenache or Grenache.
Well, thank you, Marianne, for the invitation. You know, if you bear with me, I'd like to start my comments with a poem by David Harkins. He is gone. You can shed tears that he is gone, or you can smile because he lived. You can close your eyes and pray that he'll come back, or you can open your eyes and see all he has left. Your heart can be empty because you cannot see him, or you can be full of the love that you shared. You can turn your back on tomorrow and live yesterday, or you can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. You can remember only that he is gone, or you can cherish his memory and let it live on. You can cry and close your mind, be empty and turn your back, or you can do what he'd want, smile, open your eyes, love, and go on. So I had the privilege of knowing Bob both as a student, which is kind of humorous, he was my student, a colleague and a friend. I met him in 2009 when he started his pathology residency at the U, and I was on faculty. And as others have said already, he has fascinated me from the outset because he was so unique among his peers with his academic degrees. And while his intellect was truly awe-inspiring, what stood out most was his genuine kindness and his gentle spirit. As a colleague, Bob was exceptional. His dedication to his work was matched only by his unwavering integrity. But it was in our friendship that I truly saw the depth of his character, because Bob had a way of making everyone feel valued and appreciated. During his residency years, he spent time with me learning what I had to teach him about clinical chemistry. This, of course, seemed silly to me at first, given his vast knowledge. But in his typical way, Bob approached it with humility and grace, reminding me the importance of continuous learning and growth. But perhaps what I'll cherish most about Bob was his generosity, as others have already commented on. He gave of himself freely, always ready to offer a helping hand or a listening ear. After I moved away from Utah, I became a candidate for the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society's Man and Woman of the Year campaign. And he and Marianne not only made a generous donation to my campaign, but they offered their home as a place to host a fundraising event. And while the pandemic prevented that from happening, what never stopped was his caring, his compassion, and his friendship. His kindness knew no bounds. Last September, I came to Salt Lake for a wedding, and I had a chance. Say goodbye to Bob. And as I drove to their house, I thought, how do you say goodbye to a friend? And then I realized that you don't. Because he will always be my friend, no matter where he is now. And so I just say, but that Bob, you were deeply missed, but your legacy will live on in the countless lives you have touched. And Godspeed.
We'll now open up the mic to anyone who would like to share a remembrance of Bob, and you're welcome to speak from this one or the one on the floor.
Thank you. Those are some serious steps. Elizabeth, Ben, David, thank you. Marianne, thank you. I'm not looking at you, Marianne. It was a beautiful eulogy, and it's so nice that you brought us together. I said to you a few months ago, do you really want to do this? And you said, yes, you did, and I see why you did it so well. I looked this morning, or yesterday, for the text or the email I thought you sent me to say, do you want to make remarks? And I couldn't find it. And so I said, okay, good, I'm off the hook. And then I get here today, and I wasn't going to ask you if you wanted me to make remarks, because then you'd feel obligated. And I know my wife doesn't want me to make remarks. So that's usually the deal. People don't usually ask me to talk. They ask me to stop talking. But I had two things I wanted to say today, and I feel compelled to do that. And the things I wanted to say came easy, because I'd written Bob a letter at Marianne's urging to express my feelings for him, and I'd written Marianne some notes as well. And the same theme kept coming back to me, and as we shared several times today with other people. It's strange today that we're here celebrating Bob's death, because he was all about life, the joy of life, as much as anybody that I ever knew. He was so smart, so serious, yet his trademark was not that. His trademark was his fun-loving giggle and laugh. I mean, no one ever laughed more. If anyone snow skis, you know the feeling of freedom and joy going down the hill. And apparently this is a bit the freedom of joy of Bob doing other crazy things. And he would just giggle and laugh the whole time. So I can't think of Bob sadly. I can't think of Bob in death. I can only think of him as incredible enjoyment for life. And I can't think of another person in the world I can say that about. And so Bob had that special characteristic. My second comment I can't help but make is, I think we're also here to celebrate Bob and Marianne and Bob. As much as any couple I can think of, it was never just Bob, never just Marianne. They're incredibly tightly tied. There is no two people who are more independent in marriage, yet no two people are more intertwined and interdependent than an amazing couple. So it's hard to give a tribute to Bob, which we're here to do today, and not honor Marianne as well for the wonderful person she is and the wonderful couple they made. So thank you.
I'm not going to look at you because I promise I would not cry.
It's interesting when we talk about the couple of Bob and Marianne, because when I first met Marianne, this whole little clique over here, we met at work. And as sweet and as lovely as she is, to me, when it came to working with her, she's so good at what she does. I was really intimidated. I was like, I can't go work for her. I have imposter syndrome. She's going to be the one that realizes I do not know what I'm doing. And I went to work with her, and she was lovely, and so lovely, in fact, that she was a boss and a mentor, and now a friend for a really, really very long time. And she's been a lovely, lovely friend. And when I think about Bob, there is a lot of what everyone is saying here. For me, there are a couple of words that come to mind. One was kind of like mythical, because for a long time, he was this mythical character. It's like, there's Marianne and Bob. It's like, who is this Bob dude? We never see him. She's got this partner, but I've not seen him. Because he was always off, and they were separated, but together. And then the other thing I would say is just magical. To be a partner of somebody like us, you know, we met because we worked in advertising, and you have to be, especially a woman in advertising, independent and smart and ballsy and rough and a leader. And it's really tough sometimes to find people who will be your partner, because they have to find this magical way of keeping up with you and leading, but also letting you do your thing. And it's tough. And I love that I have a husband, Rick, and before he was my husband, we went to Australia and we stayed with Bob and Marianne, and the two of them just clicked, and I thought, that is the sweetest, most wonderful thing. And for me, it was also a way, a sign and an indication, like, Rick's a keeper because he and Bob do well together so well. And then the last remembrance is just, again, Bob's smile. I always loved his smile. And we brought the boys to Utah. We have two sons, and we brought them when they were like, I think, what, 6 and 8. And so we bring them to Bob and Marianne's very mature, sedate, calm, clean house. And they welcomed us, and Bob was always so sweet. And the boys were just terrors, absolute terrors. And then at some point, we were going skiing, and they let us borrow the car, and Rick literally backed their car into the retaining wall. And even with that, Bob's like, well, what are you going to do? I'm just like, this man. So we miss him, but I know that he's here, and that's one of the things that is just, like Elizabeth said, we're going to have to be, we'll be together, but we have to be together and support one another until we are together again. And I know that Bob is just here and looking out and over us in a different way, and loving Marianne so hard, just in another way. And we're going to be here and with you and loving you closely until we're all together again. Thanks very much, everybody.
I met Bob shortly after we both moved to Utah, and my then husband worked with Bob at the U. We all kind of clicked right away, and he invited us to his very tiny apartment in the Avs. I think that we were probably the first people he had had over. And he was just so excited to have somebody over to show us two things, which just encapsulates Bob so well. I think it was his bookcases made of cinder block that he had put together himself that he was so excited to show us that could store all of his textbooks. And this literally took up the entire apartment. There was a teeny tiny place to sleep and a teeny tiny kitchen, and the rest was textbooks. And the second thing was to show us pictures of his elusive wife, Marianne, that we had only heard about. And he was also just so excited and so sweet to show us photos of Marianne. And I just, looking back on that, felt like it was just Bob. And he became just a wonderful and incredibly fiercely loyal friend to me through so many years and so many trials. And I've just been so grateful for both Bob and Marianne's friendship throughout that time.
I don't want to stand up in front of everybody. That's okay. But just, I'm thinking about Bob. When I got to know Bob, I was remodeling their house. And Bob came by, and it was always so amazing to me. I kind of had an idea about how smart he was. And he gave me his card, and it had like six or eight things that he could have on it. And so it was like, oh, he's only got an MBA and an MD. And so, but then we would talk about doing what I was doing for him. And it would always end up with him not cutting his thumbs off. So he just wouldn't get involved with any of the stuff I had to do. And you and I pretty much remodeled his, Kristen's help did the work. And Bob was always amazed by me. And I just thought it was so stupid that this guy was interested in somebody who can pound a nail, versus doing brain scientry. But I just loved his humility. And I remember the last time, one of the last times we were out on the deck, and I was holding his hand and just reeling in his courage. Yeah. It was just so striking to me. And I love him so much. Thank you.
Yeah, I think it would be better to walk over there rather than behind over there, because there are so many of you who should turn back to me. So. Yeah, please understand that English is my second language, so I may not be perfect to say about anything, the story that I have. So, my name is Kipom, and I actually flew over to here from Chicago. I was supposed to be here this morning, but flight was delayed, so I was really late. When I think about Bob, Robert Schmidt, I am actually always think about the curiosity he had. So the first dinner I could remember with him was, I was invited for the fellowship for the Pharmacotherapy Outcomes Research Center, as well as ERA, the Center for Effective Medical Testing. And part of the interview, he asked me about really kinds of the aggressive question about how many of you guys in Korea, I actually came from South Korea, how many of you guys are eating dogs? Yeah, that is kind of a really aggressive question. And actually, you know what? I would say less than 0.01%. Yeah. And I mean that, I know, I thought he was kind of aggressive at that point. Now I understand that it was just kind of the his own nature of curiosity. And after that, you know what? I bought my first house in here in Salt Lake City, actually in Daybreak area. And Marianne and Bob, both of them were my first guest to my house. And my wife, Mijin, asked about, we had really kind of the fire noodle for you, then asked Bob, are you interested in to try? And Bob said, why not? I'm interested in. So we cooked it and served it for you, and Bob tried it, just one taste. No, this is not for me. Yeah, that's the kinds of things that I can remember about Bob and his nature of curiosity that makes him really kind of a special person for me. And personally, I am not a person myself, is not being touched a lot. So after I graduate from university, graduate with my university degree in Korea with a pharmacy degree, I think I recall I cried three times. One, Mijin, she's my wife, but I think around 2007 or 8, she asked me to break up. So I cried. And we married anyway. And second time was when I moved to the United States to pursue my degree. I cried a lot on the plane. And the third moment was, I think it was the first week of the September last year. Yeah, I got a message from Bob that Bob just emailed me about. There's kind of a bad story about he was diagnosed with the end stage of the cancer, and I just, okay, I need to go. I need to see you. And booked a flight and flew back here. And I saw Bob. I stayed in your house for about an hour and a half, and I literally cried. So that's the only three times I cried over my adulthood life. So there is actually one reason why I flew over here to remember him. In terms of academic career, I'm currently serving as an assistant professor at the College of Pharmacy at the UIC. So my career advice, he actually gave me really kind of full insights about the life as an academic professor and how you decide where you are going to do. So before I got an offer and accepted offer from the UIC, I was provided with some other opportunities in other universities in the southern part of the United States. And Bob actually told me that you got to think about what is your priority. Are you interested in research? Are you interested in teaching? Or are you interested in just staying in the United States? So that actually helped me to decide, actually defer the decision a little bit further, and was able to make final decision for my career now. So unfortunately, I got a sad story from Bob about the diagnosis of the cancer, but whenever I received the email or phone call from Marianne or Bob, my wife Mijin always talked to me, you gotta go, you should not stop. So there are the reasons why, yeah, I'd love to see you, Marianne. And I gotta recall and remember Bob over my life. And I think if he is here, he's gonna be the grandparents for my four kids. So I had my first one, and so when we invited you to my house, I had two, and now the boy over there, he's 10-year-old, really kind of the crazy boy. Yeah, unfortunately, I missed that opportunity to have really kind of the great parents for, in the United States version of the great parents for my kids, but hopefully I got a chance to invite you to Chicago. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for all of your beautiful remembrances. We'll now watch a remembrance in pictures as we listen to another of Bob's many favorite songs.
Don't worry. this morning. Smile with the rising sun. Three little birds beach by my doorstep, singing sweet songs of melodies pure and true, saying,
this is my message to you, woo-woo.
Singing, don't worry about a thing, 'cause every little thing gonna be alright.
I never got to hear Bob laugh, but that smile is infectious. My friends, we began today's memorial service with an image of a star and the light from that star that moves out throughout the universe, touching everything in its path long after the physical star has died. And my friends, you are that light for Bob now. And those of you who loved Bob are now entrusted with a sacred pact to carry that smile and that light forward with you for the rest of your days. Go forth together in love. May it be so. Thank you.